your time has come. All right, 25 minutes before 11 o'clock. Thank you for tuning in. It's a beautiful Monday. Hope you had a good weekend. Hope you're enjoying your radio. We try our best to bring you some really great interviews, and the next one is going to get you thinking a little bit. I was watching this thing just last night, coincidentally, that was talking about how many people are incarcerated in the world, and the largest percentage of them is right here in this country. We tend to arrest a lot of people, and it is maybe something we need to look at. Emily Kemi is on the phone. She's an attorney. She's the creator of her lifestyle blog titled FeedingTheFamished.com, which I don't know that there's a connection between that and her book. Her book is called Drinking the Knockwater, a New Age Pilgrimage based on her personal experiences, one of which... She was in some kind of an argument with her husband. I'm going to let her explain it because I don't know that I know enough. And then she was arrested. And apparently nobody hit anybody, I think, if I have that right. And let's find out what I had right, what I got wrong, and even if I said her name right. Emily Kemi. Good morning, Emily.
Good morning. You said it right, which is amazing. So thank you.
Well, I think Robin helped me out with that. So. Give credit where credit is due. Where are you calling from? Yeah. Where are you?
Colorado.
Okay. How is it out there today?
Yeah. It's a little chilly.
A little chilly. Well, come to Florida. Yeah. It's nice here.
I would love to.
is the book about the argument and your subsequent arrest? Is that what the book is about?
Well, no, it isn't. I mean, the book, the argument and the subsequent arrest are several scenes in the book. When I write a novel, this is my second novel, and you're right, it is not about Feeding the Famished, the blog, which I can tell you about also. But the novel arose because of this situation.
Okay.
And when I write a book, a lot of factors go into it, and people's stories. People tell me stories all the time. And then they kind of sit there and bubble in my head and go, oh, this would just be a really good focus for a novel. But then you bring in all these other stories, and then it all comes together, and the characters start talking and seriously, and create this wonderful story and plot.
Oh, my gosh. So, okay. So can you, for us and for the audience, explain the...
What happened?
Yeah, what happened so that we can understand where the story comes from?
Yeah, absolutely. So it goes back to... My husband and I started dating when I was 16 and he was 17. I was raised Jewish. He was raised Catholic. We got married. Now we've been married almost 34 years. And at that point, it was less. But when this incident happened, but there was always tension between my husband's side of the family, some of the people, about my Judaism, which is very cultural, and I don't... practice,
right.
And neither of us practice religion. You know, we're more spiritual people.
It was the cultural differences, the food, the maybe the music. Or,
no, not even just the fact that I was not Catholic.
Oh, really? That's it. Oh my gosh.
Oh yeah. Okay. And so our son, at a certain point, he just, you know, we wanted to expose the kids because, you know, by Jewish law, they are Jewish. So we exposed them to both religions, and our son wanted to have our bar mitzvah when he was 13. And even though I was like, oh my gosh, I don't know if I want to go through all this, but he really wanted to, so he did. And the relationship with the other side of the family really started falling apart then. And there was a comment made about people who were Jewish having less morals than people who were Catholic.
Oh my gosh.
It started a fight. Because I thought my husband was supporting them, and it was obviously a misunderstanding, and, you know, it was late at night, and it was obviously very fraught with, you know, angst, because this had been going on for years. At that point, I think we'd been married probably almost 20 years, and there was nothing physical at all, but my husband left the house, which he often tended to do if we would be fighting, but it was late at night, and I was really worried. And it was just, it had been a very awful fight because, you know, when your other side of the family is saying things about your children, it really, it just is very, it's not good.
Right.
And so I called 911, And they ended up, after talking to me for a while and telling me all kinds of things that I did, like I must have bit my husband and all these crazy things and how, it escalated. And they were telling me things later on in the, when they took me into jail, that my son had been telling them stories about me, how awful I was. And he was asleep the entire time, and they were threatening to call social services and take our children in.
Oh,
and I was like,
gosh.
do not wake them up. They have math tests in the morning. I mean, that was the biggest thing to me. It was like, don't bother my children.
Yeah,
this is really embarrassing. All I was trying to do.
So they showed up at the house. The police were at the house at this point.
Yeah, and I wanted them to help me find my husband because I was worried. You know, I just was. And I mean, you know, the police have emblazoned on their cars to serve and protect, and I just didn't feel like that was working that night. So before I knew it, I was handcuffed, and they took me in the back of a cruiser, and I was in jail for 17 hours, and luckily for me, my husband got a very good attorney. So that's the story.
What were you charged with?
We had a restraining order.
What were you charged with?
Domestic violence. They made up all the stuff. They're like, well, you didn't want him to leave the house. I'm like, no, I didn't want him to leave the house. He was very, very upset. And so, you know, they made up all this stuff. And you hit him and you bit him. I'm like, no, I didn't do anything.
Was this in Colorado?
This was in Colorado. And that's because there are mandatory arrest laws still on the books in 21 states. And what it is that they require an arrest, the laws require an arrest, even if there's the remotest signs of domestic violence. And it starts this horrible legal process, and it can be an argument. People have been arrested for one of them smashing a wedding photo, breaking a cell phone, throwing a vase of flowers. It's just that minimal, and it's crazy. And just to get to the end of this, we had a restraining order for 3 weeks. The district attorney in my town dismissed it after 3 weeks. And later, like 6 months later, we know him socially, and we were at this black tie dinner, and he got down on one knee, and he said, Emily, will you ever forgive me for this? And I was like, I don't know. I mean, it was humiliating. It was awful. And I, for about 6 months, there were a lot of days I couldn't get out of bed. I didn't trust anybody. I was depressed. I had PTSD. My husband was very smart. He said, and I was writing my first novel at that point.
Uh-huh.
And he said, you know, you need to take a break from Sushi Tora, and you need to write down everything you can remember about this, because this will be another book one day. And I was like, I don't want to ever have anything to do with this story again.
No,
Emily, we're going to get through this. And one of the conditions of, you know, the dismissal was that we had to go to marriage counseling. And so we went to one marriage counseling session and talked to the counselor, and she said, you guys are great. You have a very good very good method of handling conflicts and confrontation, and you don't ever have to see me again. So that was crazy. I mean, it was really crazy. But for me, I mean, you got to understand, okay, I'm a Jap, okay? Do you know what that is?
I know what that is, yeah.
Mm-hmm. But,
Jewish American princess. Are you from New York originally? That's a New York term.
my dad is, and I was actually born in New York City. But, I mean, they never even made me change into the orange outfit. You know, I went in there wearing white Ralph Lauren chinos and a appropriately blue and white striped.
There you go.
Polo
fashion
polo
shirt.
Oh, no.
Yeah, I know. And they never made me change, I think, because they realized it was really odd. And it was basically, and I've talked to my attorney since then, you know, well, at the time, and he said, this was an abuse of discretion. You could sue the county. And I said, I don't want to have anything to do with this ever again.
Well, is it more satisfying to actually have written the book, though, than if you had a lawsuit?
Yeah. There's no question. And actually, my first book took about 3 years to write. This one took 5 because it was, and I was dealing with some other stuff, and I'm a very active volunteer in our community doing stuff, and
yeah, it sounds
I was
like
really
it.
Busy. But
So, yeah. All right. So, so the title of the book is "Drinking the Knock Water." Try to and this is a novel, but it's based on the true story you just told, correct? Or just
Well, it's everything has been fictionalized, but yes, that did happen, and I decided at a certain point I was ready to tell the story, but it's been fictionalized, and it actually takes place in New York, and. But the incidents of me being arrested and being in jail, that is pretty accurate. That's not
okay. I knew what Jap was. I don't know what Knockwater is. What is that?
So there is a shrine in Ireland, Knock Shrine, and it has holy water, as most shrines and churches do.
Uh-huh.
And so the book is the basis of the book is about hypocrisy. And there's the running through the whole thing is religious intolerance
that's
experiences.
Interesting.
Yeah. There are other experiences in the book that other characters deal with, and the protagonist deals with. That there's pain. Pain's a recurrent theme in the novel, and water is used throughout the entire book as a healing metaphor.
I gotcha. Oh wow, I like it already.
You know,
when you say it's about hypocrisy, I can see sort of this, and help me out if I'm even close. But when you talk about religious hypocrisy, especially in the story you just told us, if my religion tells me love one another, period, you know, but I don't love you because you're not my religion, that's very hypocritical.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's what the book is about. And the book is about people are just people, live and let live. So the protagonist and her husband in this book are, the husband is a infertility physician, and she's a therapist, and they run an infertility clinic, and she's dealing with a failed pregnancy herself, so she questions herself whether she has a right to even counsel these people. And every year, because of her failed pregnancy, they take a hand-picked group of five couples to England to visit holy sites and spiritual sites, you know, some of the, you know, the feminine goddess sites, and also they're in Canterbury, which I even though I was raised Jewish, I love cathedrals. I find them very, very peaceful places, and whether or not anyone tells me I have a right or do not have a right to feel peaceful in a church, I do. And a lot of times, it's kind of funny, because I don't go to church, we don't go to synagogue, we don't do any of that, but I find myself closer to being spiritual or God or whatever the force is when I'm in nature, bicycling with my husband and I rode.
Yeah,
bike.
Sure. I can relate to everything you're saying. Yeah, I got
hiking. Okay, yeah.
The same thing happens to me in the cathedral, by the way. I've only been to one, really. It's the one in New York, St. Patrick's.
I love it, yeah.
But there's just something about that. I don't know what it is, and I'm not really that religious either. But it is. There's something about it. Like, there's something awesome there or something. I don't know.
Well, there's this, and I bring this up in the novel, there's this tension between a house built for God, and I have some issues with that too. But house built for God for some people, but it stays up. These things are old buildings, and they're marvels of science. So you have this tension between faith and reason that I also discuss a lot in the novel.
Yeah,
because they battle in real life, but in reality, in a cathedral, they're all brought together and work hand in hand. And so this book, the U.S. Review of Books gave it a really good review, and it says it illuminates and rejuvenates because it does. It makes you, like you said when we first started talking, this book, I hope, and that's the case with my blog as well, my point about writing these stories is just to have people take a step back and think and go, that was an interesting topic. And, you know, I don't write about lunch unless it was meaningful for some reason. But on the other hand, the other aspect of feeding the famished is that I create recipes So,
recipes.
Yeah. So, I mean, I feed the famished as far as recipe creation, but I also hope to feed the mind and the soul and the heart. So that's what I'm doing. And my books are more serious, but humorous too.
I had a feeling. I had a feeling. Yeah, I just wondered that actually. Do you know one of the things I've often thought with when people talk about a cathedral versus you know, a little shack or something as a house of worship, and I've often looked at it like this: if I have three children, and one is three, and one is 13, and one is 30. Let's say I have a really big span in age. And all three children want to show me they love me. The 30-year-old might buy me a car, all right? The 13-year-old...
Good for you. That would be cool.
Wouldn't that be nice? The 13-year-old might, I don't know...
Because I have an almost 26-year-old who's still in medical school. So like, don't see that happening for a while.
You'll get a car. You'll get a car. But anyway, so my point is, the 3-year-old would, you know, give me a card made with her hands printed on the... You know,
yeah.
Okay.
But it'd be lovely.
But in both cases, if I'm in as the role of God as a parent, they're showing their love to me, and it doesn't matter because I see love in that little painting from the little child. The 13-year-old maybe gave me, I don't know, a gadget or an app or something for my phone. And even though there's more money, more, you know, they all are showing love, and I think that's the same thing. If that's why the Knockwater thing resonates with me, because I often think that people think they're the only ones doing it the right way.
And, exactly.
And you're not. You're,
and if their club is the only good club, and because you don't look like them or have the same beliefs, you don't get to be in their club. And then they get to cut everybody out. And that's why this whole group of people on this spiritual pilgrimage, I call it the fertility tour, in the book, they're all kind of misfits. I have a lesbian couple who is trying to go through... you know, IVF, in vitro fertilization, and they're questioning how is this going to work in our society.
David Crosby, just call David Crosby.
He'll take care of it.
I have several friends who have gone through this, and but there's also an Indian couple who, you know, from India, who are dealing with kind of looking in to the world, you know, to the American world, and how can we fit in?
Uh-huh.
And it's just, so it's kind of a bunch of life misfits.
But and I see the connection with your son wanting a bar mitzvah and the Catholic relatives.
And me freaking out.
Yeah, the Catholic relatives having a hard time with this. But your son was saying somewhere in his soul, this is what I want to do. This is what I want to be. And this is my way of showing my gratitude toward my parents, toward my creator, toward whoever, you know, and that's why I can relate.
A good person.
Yes, I'm a good person.
And to be told after studying for a bar mitzvah, which is rigorous, to be told, well, you don't have as good of morals as we do. It's like that, just kind of like,
that's crazy.
Oh my gosh, it was crazy. And you're also talking about, so you didn't talk about that 13-year-old kid. You've got the 30-year-old with the car and the 3-year-old with the hand on the card. The 13-year-old is starting to become a thinking, reasoning human being.
That's right.
And and so they're going to be, they're starting to make their way as an adult.
Yeah.
And then when someone slaps them down on something so irrational.
Right,
and,
very good.
So I guess that's why I went to jail.
Are you trying to form a movement where you get that kind of a law off the books, the mandatory arrest laws?
Well, actually, there is a movement already, and the district attorney in my town wanted me to take part in it, but I didn't want to have anything to do with it. But through writing this, I told them, I said, I'm going to be writing a book. I'm going to do it that way. And there is a movement to rewrite the law to remove this harsh language. Obviously, the issue is, you know, when there really is domestic violence, because... domestic violence occurs in a house where people often love each other, and it's this whole, the legal system is financially stressful, it's emotionally stressful. People who have been convicted of domestic violence have trouble getting jobs. So they are being rewritten, hopefully, and it's only on the books of 21 states. So I think it used to be across the country. But so they've been getting rid of them. They're also, in my county, they've created an adult diversion program where there has been a crime committed of some sort, but they shouldn't convict of domestic violence. And it's an acknowledgement that the mandatory arrest part of the law has some unintended consequences.
Well, I've already figured out that you've got a whole universe around you. I just went to your website, feedingthefamished.com, and I'm looking forward to reading some of these entries in your blog. Who's the young woman at the drums? Who's that?
The young woman on the drums?
Yeah.
Oh, so about two times a year, I will do a blog post for various organizations in the area in Northern Colorado, just kind of as my donation. And that one was for an organization called Partners Mentoring Youth.
Mm-hmm.
And the name of the young woman on the drums, I only know her as Rose. And what they do is, it's a really neat organization. They take adults, they pair them with children or young adults who are having problems in their own homes, and they're partners. They do activities with them. It may just be cooking dinner. They may go to a movie. They may go get their nails done. But it's just a really great way to build up a young person's self-esteem, have a responsible adult in their family where maybe their home lives are unstable. And so there's another great program in our area, Habitat for Humanity does home builds. And I know that's a national thing, but the one I wrote is about a high school, an alternative high school that partners with Habitat, and these kids build homes. So I like to do that.
You've got a lot going on. I just liked your Facebook page, by the way. So I don't know if you get told when somebody likes a page. I don't know if you get a little ding. Hey, somebody just liked
it. I just got that. Thank you. Yeah, and I'm also the food writer, food and lifestyle for the Greeley Tribune. So I'm busy, but it's fun busy.
Yes, and I love what you told us about drinking the knock water. It so resonates with me. I see it all the time. I see hypocrisy all the time. And the best teachers we have, whether they're religious or not, are the ones who point it out all the time, and you are obviously one of them, Emily. Thank you for being on our show. The website I went to was feedingthefamished.com. Is that the best place to get the book, or is there other advice?
Yes, well, you can go there to get the book, and it leads you directly to Amazon. So you can go, it's on Amazon in hardcover and for Kindle. And if you do Nook or iTunes, go to iTunes or Barnes & Noble. And then it is gradually being sent out to independent bookstores. But for right now, Amazon is your best bet.
Emily Kemmy,
unless you're in Colorado.
Thank you so much for being on the air with us today. And if you're ever in Florida, we would love to have you in the studio.
I'd love to. Thank you.
All right, we will take a little break, and we'll be right back.
Weather is brought to you by MyFWC.com. Safe boating is no accident. So this Monday, partly sunny. There can be a shower in spots, especially during the afternoon hours. The high 79 on the coast, 84 inland. Partly cloudy and mild Monday night. Watch out for some fog late at night and into Tuesday morning. The overnight low, 62 to 66. Later Tuesday, partly sunny and warm with a shower in spots near the coast. The high 80 at the coast, 86 inland. From the